know you're doing. I know you do.
What am I doing?
You're making me fall in love with you. You're doing it now.
I'm not doing it. And is it working?
What about you, Roberto? You're not a fan of the underwear either, are you?
That's true, but you know, recently I've discovered bamboo underpants.
Ah, now yeah. Go on, tell us about bamboo underwear.
They're hardy. They want to be around my gaff.
Just the fact that you had to, you did this 30-hour flight, right? You were in New Zealand, you just got back recently. You had to do the, what is it, 60 hours total? Yeah. Going and coming back, it's a lot.
It's a lot, and you know, it's hard to fill flirting with flight attendants. It's hard to stretch that out to 60 hours. I can achieve 45 hours perpetually at best. At best. But every man has limits.
Yeah.
Don't just play number four. And he's called Klaus, and he communes with the dead. And the dead are always plaguing him and hassling him. So he takes lots of drugs to kind of suppress his death ability. So he's kind of a mad drug addict when we first meet him.
Ah! Number three.
Get out of his chair.
It's just like old times.
Best funeral ever.
Is that my skirt?
What? Oh, yeah, this. I found it in your room. It's a little dated, I know, but it's very breathy on the bits.
Listen up.
Oh, Kelson, please.
Look, I know you don't like to do it, but I need you to talk to Dad.
I can't just call Dad in the afterlife and be like, Dad, could you stop playing tennis with Hitler for a moment and take a quick call?
Since when? That's your thing.
I'm not in the right frame of mind.
You're high?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, how are you not listening to this nonsense?
No, manifesting.
Come on, chop, chop. You always were a stubborn bastard.
I don't know about you, but I need a drink.
Oh. What's that guy called with the nice big nose that's in everything good?
Oh, that guy.
You know.
Who, Adrian Brody?
Yes. Adrian Brody.
Yeah?
Yeah.
I'm sure he'd do it.
I'd love it to be Adrian Brody.
Are you going
to
have kids?
Are you offering?
Yes.
That's what they're, but that's still now they have thing. Actual power.
And it was, yeah,
that's a they, lot yeah, of money and power.
It's been, you know, largely disseminated a lot. But you're right, they have a lot of influence.
It's crazy.
Like even on the road out to Heathrow Airport in West London, there's a motorway and it takes you past this beautiful cathedral. And there was tons and tons of scaffolding up the side of the cathedral for quite a few months. And then suddenly there was a big tarp over the cathedral. So for your view, your view from the motorway was the tarp, but they had done the tarp in the exact veneer of the cathedral. Do you know what I mean? So yeah. It looked, because they were like, and I was like, why is that? There was scaffolding and now there's this big tarp there and it looks like they've gone to great expense for the tarp to look exactly like the cathedral. Yeah. Huge piece of fabric, you know, that covers an entire cathedral. I was like, why is that? And apparently it was because Prince Charles was driving past and was like, I love that cathedral. And it's been ruined by all this scaffolding and everything. We can't have that. So they created a giant cathedral blanket to go over the top of the construction.
It's a bit much.
Because Prince Charles was like, it's just not as, it's an eyesore.
You know what would have been funny? If he had that same type of rigor, you know?
Yeah.
And be like, there's a lot of hungry kids in England.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
We
yeah.
can't have that.
Yeah.
But instead he's like, no, we can have that. I just don't want to see them. Yeah. Put them in the cathedral.
Could you just throw
have a tarp?
Could you throw a tarp of a happy child over the top?
That's what it is. He's walking in the streets throwing tarps on people. And there you go.
So stuffy inside when you're in there for too long. And I remember you just would like sunbathe between takes and take off all your clothes.
Yeah, and there was groundskeepers like giving me very, very disapproving looks.
Going back to Toronto.
Yeah, back to Toronto.
How's filming treating
you? Toronto, as the Irish natives call it. What?
How's filming treating you?
I'm also quite hungry. Tummies are rumbling.
Bending. It's totally insane.
Imagine if you're one of the kids there now, or even the princes now, and you're growing up in there, you spend all this time with the queen, and then you do some research and you're like, oh shit, this bitch killed my mother.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah, you go to France, you know.
Yeah.
You do some research.
You're like, Jesus Christ, I didn't this is suspicious.
You're like, this bitch killed my mother, and this asshole isn't even my father.
Yeah, that's exactly it. Yeah. No, crazy that is.
And I'm strangely good at tennis.
Yeah.
Two words. Oh my God. Stab. Dead. Happy. Superman dies. Batman begins. Batman begins.
No.
Dies.
My God. This is a really hard one. Skip.
Die.
Skip.
Die.
No.
Yeah, I don't want to give up. Die.
I think it's great. I think it's awesome. You know, especially because it's set in Dallas this year, so all of a sudden at the end, we get this bizarre snowstorm to kind of add a shot in the arm to our climax.
We have a Robert in his natural habitat.
Yeah. Oh, my tan looks quite good on that.
Yeah.
I really like this bit of a physical.
Oh, gosh.
If Laurel and Hardy were in the same body. We were in an alleyway in Hamilton City. It's an hour outside of Toronto. There was a kind of a Jeep, sort of a dune buggy style thing, and our camera operator, Sean, was on the back. And also, you know, so we were coordinating with the choreography of the visual effects, so... You know, between myself and Justin, we had to figure out, okay, with the time from the start of the alleyway to the end of the alleyway, how many kind of fights can we get in, you know, and make them all very different to each other. And so, and then it was a sort of figuring out what sort of pace we're going at. So the driver of the Jeep was a big part of it too.
You were ruined after that.
Oh yeah. I was.
Do you know what, right? I was in a similar scenario recently. I was in London. And I was going to go meet a mate. And I was in the area about an hour early. So I was like, you know what? I'm going to get a fucking massage. It's going to be nice, right?
Yeah,
so I
went to this good
Thai massage parlor just looking for a massage. And ended up, ended up coming out of there.
Poseidon.
It was a happy ending.
You came up Poseidon.
On paper. But it was not happy.
It was very awkward.
It was an awkward scenario.
Yeah.
Because... Like the room was sweltering, right?
And that's
hot. I had to really concentrate to get myself over the edge. and then like she was kind of going, she was sort of whispering in a really sort of clandestine way, going, "No, you." And I was like, "Oh, I really didn't want to do this." And she was like, "Oh, you need to give me the cash. You should give it me directly. you don't give it to the girl at the thing." I was like, "I didn't."
Can you please get back on my back?
Because she wasn't even a masseuse.
Oh, that's like, the funniest thing.
She'd just been sort of poking at me for about 5 minutes. And then she flipped me over and I was like, all right, you know. So then I went out to the ATM. It was an ATM.
Right? He's too funny.
I was like, got 40 quid out.
that's
And then as I turned around and she was there next to me by the ATM.
Weird.
And I was like, oh, here, sorry about that. Nice to meet you. I don't know what the fuck I was saying. And as I gave her the money... Four men were walking up the street and they went, "Way!" As I was making the transaction.
It's funny because one time in LA, I thought like I was...
This was years ago, by the way.
Yeah, years ago with my buddy Rob.
Make me.
Oh, then again, a little exercise couldn't hurt. Yeah.
Oh yeah, and also fans... Sarongs. Seriously, just try the sarong. Give it a go.
He's serious about the goddamn sarong, and you think he's messing, but he's not, because he's actually wearing one. He commits to the bit.
I wear it all the time. It's so comfortable.
You get away with a lot, though.
Yeah, because you give yourself the permission.
Yeah, that's what I learned, yeah.
You know, that's all you have to do. Just but I'll go, tell you I one like thing. That, I'm doing that.
I'll tell you one thing.
We're
Nice dress.
Not a single drop of coffee.
Dad hated caffeine.
Well, he hated children too, and he had plenty of us.
Okay, well, sorry, I'm just gonna go murder Mom. I'll be right back.
That's not what I was...
All my clothes to already be in the closet, all unpacked.
Hung up.
Yeah.
Nice. Awesome. This is lovely.
What is that?
Off, just fanning myself.
Oh, I thought it was like you're beating hard.
Yeah, like...
I actually had a rune there a while ago, but it's all faded off.
It's just
off
called the nipple.
You're going to have that one for a while.
That was amazing. A tassel rune.
As well, Robert, you and Tom have a new podcast coming out. Tell me about The Earth Locker and how did all of this come about?
Well, it came about from many chats in parks in Toronto and over training and stuff. And we were very, very interested in sort of food and health and
family. When you're 29 and 30, you start to notice tiny little changes with your body, just in the same way when you were 13 and a half to 14, perhaps 15 if you were me, right?
Klaus.
I saved the lecture. I was already leaving.
Klaus.
I saved the lecture. I was already leaving.
Hey, where are you going?
Nope.
What?
I'm not giving you a ride.
Come on, man. You know I can't drive.
I don't...
Okay, great. I'll just get my things, too.
And, Peter... Nope, won't come to me.
You get a taste of what Five can do. Not only with his ability to jump through space and time, but also how physically...
Oh, beep-a-zing!
On that topic, has anyone pissed themselves on set?
Robert.
Oh, Robert.
Oh, no, not pissed himself.
Slanderous lies about me.
But we were all on a boat.
Oh, yeah. I did piss myself.
And that shit destroys the buildings from underneath.
Oh.
It's like mental insane. And I remember my property agent, this buff South African man called Michael Lintz, proper white supremacist. No, he wasn't. I'm only joking. He's like the sweetest, loveliest man ever.
But hanging out with him was cool, man. Every night at the hotel, he was like banging out tunes on the guitar and the piano, blues. You think he's still a little bit Jerry Lee Lewis, you know what I mean? Great Balls of Fire.
Classic film.
Oh, yeah.
Classic.
So that was fun. That was great. It was a lovely project. It's one
of like... Find sort of technology from being a pre-primitive or digital native. You know, I'm deeply suspicious of all technology.
I do get quite naked in the second episode.
Yes.
I had a full scene with Pogo just wearing like a tiny little skimpy brief, actually.
I enjoyed
it. So he was about crotch height. Look at you with the runes on your arms. You're gorgeous.
She has the costume.
That's lovely. Oh, yeah, you're Isabel. That's lovely.
I just had tea delivered.
Yeah, Simon and Isabel have a little thing later on in the films. Can I have your number? Yeah, sweet. Success. Okay, let's wrap this up.
Are you excited to film those scenes with Jemima and like...
I mean, the character that I play in Fortitude is really bizarre and extreme.
I went, that fellow there! Take his life and carve my likeness into his flesh.
Do you feel like you miss a home base since you're always on the go?
Desperately, man.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to use this forum to talk about my unique suffering. The suffering that's done in consistent luxury.
Yeah.
Now, this, most of you are going to really, really hate me for this. But you know what? Fuck you guys. Because I'm a person too. No, I'm only joking.
Lui qui joue Simon, Simon est avec nous. Robert, bonjour.
Frankie, you've given me a tingle. Bonjour.
Ça va? Oui.
Très bien.
Oh!
Et toi?
Perfect. Okay.
It was weird, actually. I was in a little shop buying something. And I didn't feel anything until there was a lady behind the counter. And she went, oh! Like that, right? Started kind of whooping.
And you're like, it's new. You like it?
It's just, I know I'm trying the sarong, see how it goes.
I put it on the wrong way, I'm sorry. But I'm glad that you're impressed.
Ooh, I'm popped out.
Yeah, yeah. I'm glad you're impressed, lady. You're welcome.
So, yeah. She started kind of, and then it was her reaction, and then a beat later, the the ground sort of rolled like that.
Oh, that's so strange.
Oh my God.
It was fab, you know.
Hello, how are you? How are you doing? Good, come over here, come over. Join the interview. I don't know, just because you look
Mexicana.
Nice and you have a nice energy about you.
Soy Mexicana.
Say hello to this camera, it's for Paige to premiere.
Hola, soy de Mexico. I'm a mother of four.
And you're gorgeous, you are.
Thank you so much, I'm 50. So I'm really happy to be here with the two beautiful creatures. You are who?
I'm Robert, and that's, what's your first name again?
Kimmy.
Kimmy, yeah.
You look like my one of my sons.
Oh, yeah?
You're very cute.
Oh, that's very lovely. Thank you very much.
From where? London?
I'm from Ireland originally, but I live in London. Yeah.
Cool.
What are you doing here?
Oh, I have, like, 2 days with my daughter. She's working for a very big company. It's called UTAS. It's an airplane, big, huge company, and she's the one paying for it. I was here.
Nice.
Yeah, she's 24.
I'm a couple of days in San Diego. I'm 25.
Cool.
Do you want to introduce us?
Yes.
Fantastic.
Yeah. She's also in the Televisa. You know what Televisa is? I'm in Mexico.
Oh, well, yeah?
Uh-huh,
oh, cool.
The big things. Yes, why
lovely.
Not? You, an agent or someone? Really?
Your next ex-boyfriend? Good God, ladies, calm down.
If somebody have your everything, your addresses, or if you can put it here, because I don't know how these things work.
I'll give you my email.
Okay, but put it in notes. Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, good. Girls, you're so lovely, too. I'm sorry.
No, it's fine. It's great.
Oh, it's because
we're all.
I'm not sure how much time we have, but it's fine.
This is all part of the interview.
Okay.
This is great. Here you go. Lovely to meet you.
Lovely to meet you.
Yes. Okay.
Bye-bye.
Keep all that in.
No, I should. I feel like everyone will be very entertained by that. I don't know if they can hear it though, because the microphone was like over here. I was like,
this man just gave my email to a Mexican lady.
Females are very fussy.
That sounded personal to David Attenborough, didn't it? Females are very fussy.
I actually now want to see that as a film, Rob. Is there any chance we can get you making it?
Well, we could probably imprison Alanis Morissette in a Vietnamese POW camp. And then forget the film. We'll just leave her there. Do the world a favour. Ah, oh, Alanis, I'm only joking.
Have you ever played Game Consequences?
No.
Is that the one you go... Oh, no, that's Concentration. Sorry. I clearly wasn't concentrating.
Oh, but she has a lot, yeah.
Her excitement grows.
She's not the only one. And everybody lives their lives on screens and it's all a bit lonely. And so, like, when I've been in Toronto on the trams and such, I'm always like, what are you reading? Like, you know, I'm always asking people questions and that.
Heathrow terminals, 1, 2, 3,
just going on holidays.
It's a holiday.
Oh, lovely. Because I just feel despair when I'm around multitudes of people who are all spending energy not interacting.
Yeah, they're all alone in their own world.
But also making an effort to be alone in their own world.
Hang on. Oh, hang on.
Luther from Umbrella Academy.
Jolene.
Dolly Parton.
Yeah. What do you think?
She did have a humongous bust for the size of her shoulders.
She's got a glorious big breast and a glorious big songwriting brain.
Oh. I did a play a few years ago, and every night the actress across me had to spit in my face. And I'll be honest, I started to really enjoy it.
That's the last thing I expect you to say.
It's true. I'm wearing leggings. Look at that.
Oh, fuck.
You know, but you go, wow, bang, boom ba da boom bang. I don't necessarily like your art, but fuck me, you're you, aren't you?
It was like having more, like three or four, or the volume of three or four oysters all down.
Yeah, you got it.
And we see, yeah, you know, girls, we really take care of that. That you're kind of fit. So, is your car...
It's not okay if I wank you off the ground. We're not touching.
I was staring into those big, beautiful eyes. He's like a handsome shark.
Do you think it's farther to top?
Do I look like a tall guy?
Sorry. Do you think it's far to... I can't fucking say that line. What's wrong with me? Do you think it's far to the top? To what? The top. Do you think it's... Sorry. Do you think it's far to the top? Oh, fuck.
Marry me,
and we'll do some sort of womb reversal swap where I'll have all the children and I'll raise them and breastfeed them and you won't have to do anything. You can just chill out at home and watch the Ricky Lake show or whatever.
You're gonna get an 8 for that one.
Yes.
I was like, I'm organizing a big dinner for all of us. Like for all of the ones I liked.
Right, before I go, I have a quiz.
Great, it's I love a quiz.
This one's called Tender Stem Broccoli. Reminds me of a maimed hand when it's been cut just right. Like when it's been cut where the bushy heads come off.
Cut.
Even that brings with it a bit of trepidation as it's skewered by a fork and dragged out of a hot stew. I eat it quick before Kelsey Grammer's suave voice drifts into my head. So, I don't know where that one was going. It carries on. But
oh, God. I mean,
you're always wearing something eccentric. Oh, you're wearing a sarong today, a mesh see-through shirt.
I urge all men listening and watching to give the sarong a go. Like I was in Indonesia last year. I was in Bali for a bit, and it's very like all the men wear them there, and it's very masculine. You know what I mean? It's very like it's like a kilt, and then on a nice warm day, you get a lovely breeze up your Poseidon testicles.
Yeah.
Bear versus a 400-pound shark.
Shark.
Hey boys, what are you doing?
Cooking for lunch.
Ooh, lunch.
I'm making an evil salad. Balsamic vinegar makes it evil.
Listen,
nice. What's yours?
No, I don't know. I don't know. I'm trying to think of what was the question again?
You have a pretty good improvising superpower. Yeah. You can improvise like a beast.
Let's just go with improv. Ironically, when asked a question, just silence for about 3 minutes. And then at the end goes, improv!
You think it's farther to top? Sorry, let me say that again. Hey, do you think it's farther to top? Fuck me, I've lost, I've forgotten how to speak.
To say, but I think you have really nice feet.
Oh, thanks, my love. I just had a pedicure.
I had to do Richard III down Skype to Trevor Nunn, who was in London. Trevor Nunn, who'd been directing Shakespeare plays for 40 years, literally 40 years. And I had to do Richard III down Skype from LA.
That was your audition.
And then I got the part.
That must have been a killer fucking audition if you got it through Skype.
It was terrible.
Really?
Yeah. But someone just said to him, he's good. He is good. Seriously, someone just went, no, he could do it. He will do it. He could do it. You know, but the audition did, I can't say for sure, man. Like I can't be the voice of others, but I can assume based on my instincts over the years that I tell you one thing. I think that audition did not help me getting the job.
Odds. And another one called Neverwhere. He's just the fucking shit.
So you're reading,
is, as they say in the ghetto.
Da 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 da, healthy smoothie, Robert Sheehan, make you feel good. Vitality.
Keep reading books.
Books are awesome.
Books are awesome. Books are a far more gratifying piece of art than a film is. But you can then go see the film after you've read the book, right? So read The Mortal Instruments, you bunch of thicks.
So if you guys only had 2 to 3 days left before the apocalypse arrived, where would you go?
I'd be like disco party, yeah, Berlin. Luminous banana hammock stretched across the top of my head. Yeah.
Yeah.
Body paints, ecstasy.
I'd smoke a joint with my dad.
Would you? Can I be there?
Yeah.
An Easy Rider was so affecting because it was the first kind of filmic representation of, no, there's this kind of movement based on love going on, and there's a lot of people into it and involved, and here's some of those characters in that.
Talking to strange facts ladies is entertaining. That's like
she was quite an interesting lady though, wasn't she? She had a very strange energy about her.
No, she did. I was intrigued.
Yeah. Hi Robert, how you doing?
Very good.
We did very, very well.
It's so good to see you guys back. And can I just say I was Well, I'm loving that season 2 is coming back at the end of this month. And Tom, you've said you're so excited about it. Why? And why should we be excited?
I just think that it's got so much more to offer this year. You know, I think what I love about season one is that it's set up these characters, it's set up these relationships. We set up like the challenges that these guys have. And then now we're throwing them into a whole new world where they're going to be challenged even further and taken on events in history, really, which is the really interesting part for me, and how they're going to screw it up in their own unique way.
How are you guys finding the fan reaction? Because, like, you know, season one, no one knew what it was about, and then it dropped on Netflix and it was everywhere. People loved it. Tom Hopper's arms appeared on Instagram. Like, how do you react when stuff like that is happening?
I with a rather large pinch of salt, really. You know, it's that sort of thing. It's great. One thing is amazing is that reaction, you know, because you work so hard for so many months to try and make this thing as good as it could possibly be, and the scripts were so good, and also the comics were so good that you feel a great sense of responsibility to not screw it up. So we all worked incredibly hard to make sure that didn't happen. So it was kind of an element of just sitting back and enjoying people connecting with these characters and stuff, right, Rob? I think that was what was so nice about it. We did the hard work, and then we watched people enjoy it, which is always the best payoff.
Did you ever see any seahorses when you were in Dubai?
Seahorses?
Yeah.
No.
Oh, right.
Why? Are you a big seahorse guy?
Yeah, huge.
I would probably go back to, like most of us, Nazi Germany and do that version of it.
Like most of us, Nazi Germany.
Well, you know...
To kill Hitler is what he means.
Yeah.
All right.
Well, how are you going to
do
that?
Well, it's a common... I know, right? It's a common... Well, I'd be number five. There you go.
Yeah, but is it real Aiden or is it like number five?
What are the parameters of this?
It's probably Aiden. It's real
me.
It's real
you. Then I would probably just go back to the 60s.
You could at least try.
Give it a go, Aiden.
I'm good. I'm going to stay away from there. But probably the 60s. 60s were a good time.
Good time.
Stoned.
Stones.
Why not?
Either, you know,
imagine how many concerts you could go to.
Song. One of the two.
Who plays Vanya? Aidan Gallagher, who plays Five. Robert Sheehan, who plays Klaus.
Bonsoir.
What the hell did we do now?
I suppose not dying in the apocalypse is their biggest challenge going into season two, right? That's kind of where we left them at the end of season one, was attempting to make their escape from a doomed world. A doomed present. God, this is a tough crowd. Jesus Christ.
Having things clacked onto the side.
So then don't put them on. You'll just bring the mic closer and you're good.
Oh, a bit closer.
Like this, the three finger rule. There you go.
Three finger rule.
Yeah, put them all in.
Listen, I had a very different childhood to you.
But you had a very similar night. So. I don't think it got nowhere near the marketing push that Stranger Things got. Stranger Things was everywhere.
In fairness, Umbrella was pretty blitzkrieg.
Really?
To use Nazi connotations. Yeah. Because I'll be honest, some of the Umbrella propaganda, if you will... had a lot of the color scheme of the Third Reich, you know, black and white, red.
So what you're saying is Netflix and Umbrella Academy are bringing back the classics.
Netflix are, I'm here to reveal on the Pantelis podcast that Netflix are pushing a subliminal Nazi
that's
agenda.
What it is,
they want to reinstall the Third Reich and call it the Netflix Reich.
Yeah. They knew how to make a point.
And I mean, they were snappy dressers, let's be honest.
Yeah, because they had, who was it? Armani,
Hugo
Gucci,
Boss.
Hugo Boss, yeah.
You get a blood clot out, a couple of broken ribs, and a fractured skull. A fractured skull, Nige.
Right.
And she made a joke about a dead rapper, XXXTentacion, his name was. And
XXXTentacion.
He knows this kind of shit.
It's pronounced Xtentation.
It's pronounced dyslexic.
Xtentation.
So he died. He was murdered. Right. And he was a young man, like 20 years old.
Because of his name.
Well, people are like, I gotta fucking say this. So what happened was she made a joke and be even weirder.
What's extentation? What does that mean?
Okay, look, I thought when I first read it, I thought his name was extensions. Okay. And then I was told, no, you have to pronounce all three X's. So his name is XXX Tentacion.
But what's Tentacion mean?
He just made it up. That's his name.
Just the
Tentacion.
I think it's supposed to sound like temptation.
It doesn't.
But extent is a word.
Yeah.
Temptation is a word.
XXX Tentacion.
I think it's supposed to get you confused about extension, passion.
It's supposed to
But he was a young rapper. He was a child. He was confused too.
Yeah. And also I stipulated in my contract that I have to show my nipples at least once in every scene.
Yeah, it'd be interesting. I mean, some of the people they knight, man. It's disgraceful.
Yeah.
Like, they knighted Nick Clegg recently.
Who the fuck is Nick Clegg?
He's just, you know, here's who Nick Clegg is, right? Frankie Boyle, right? Yeah. Our all shared love of the great Frankie Boyle had a joke about Nick Clegg. He's like, Nick Clegg, leader of the Liberal Democrats, a guy who looks like he shouts out sorry when he comes.
He's a politician.
Oh, he's definitely ferocious, this fella. Did you ever hear that thing that dogs evolved to have human faces?
Well, they say they look like their owners, don't they?
Oh, well, he's far better looking than me, so...
Should we go back to our thing?
What? I didn't get it.
What do you want to tell people? Because your fans are crazy, okay? They love you, but in a good way. They love you a lot.
Yeah, they like me, and I'm definitely mentally ill.
What message do you want to send?
I think the first line says, you got a prize for the rising star. Better being the rising star than the falling star, right?
Yeah, exactly. Do you know what's so funny, man?
What?
Is that I was given this lovely accolade, mm-hmm. but then they took it back. They revoked it off me. They did, because it was part of the Berlin Film Festival. Uh-huh. And I said, oh, how lovely. You know what? I'm working on those dates. But you know what? I thanks, though. And they went, oh, well, if you're not available, we're not going to give you the prize.
Welcome to Hollywood.
Yeah. Welcome to Berlin.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Scumbags.
Season 2.
I don't know.
March, May, maybe next year.
It's completely at the behest of Netflix, who, as we said earlier in the podcast, are pushing a subliminal Third Reich agenda.
Yeah.
I think that's...
You know what I like about them?
That's fair to say.
They could take a joke. It's true.
You know, that X in Netflix is starting to look a lot like a
swastika. When you think about it.
They don't have any emotional intelligence. No. And, you know, school is this weird experience where you go in and you're told to memorize a bunch of data, a bunch of very, very strange data, be it, you know, history or geography, this kind of biased view of an education, and then regurgitate it at the end, you know, to pass into phase 2 of life. And it's just like, there's no emotional intelligence there. There's no, you know, if you were to teach kids by continually assessing them instead of going, you have to, you know, do
memorize
8 essays and it might be this, and blah, you know, at the end.
Because people evolve.
Yeah, exactly. People fail and then they come back and then they fluctuate, you know? And I think to
like
kind
my
of,
weight.
Exactly. God bless you. And to expect people to behave like a fucking perfect graph is so inhuman, and it's like the educative system in its ignorance has sort of contaminated us by sort of compelling us to believe that in ourselves we can go like that right through our adolescence.
And nobody can.
Nobody can.
Unrealistic expectations that you're setting on these
failure
kids.
Is a profoundly helpful part of life.
Huge.
You know what I mean? And so we go into a sort of a strange experience in school. I really have been thinking about this a lot. And it affects how much we can cope with other people who disagree fervently with us. Do you know what I mean?
In ancient Roman times, they used to have these chats and then figure it out for real in the Colosseum.
All right, lads, go.
Yeah, like I believe it was Nero who was upped by Caligula. So... I believe it was Nero that brought in 400 lions into the Colosseum to fight gladiators. 400 African lions, male African lions. And then Nero got 400 bears in.
Well, it's kind of, I imagine some would end.
You know, in New Zealand as well, they have these ferns of a kind of a silvery quality. So when the moonlight hits them, they glow. The Maori people used to use them as literal arrows they used to put on the ground.
as markers to sort of guide them through the moonlit forest. Isn't that cool?
It's funny that...
Well, Joseph Mengele, who was known as the...
Mengele?
The... What was he?
Nazi
the,
scientist?
Yeah, the Dark Angel. Wasn't he the something angel?
Yeah, they all had weird names.
For something angel. But he was a horrible, horrible, monstrous human being who was fascinated with identical twins and would regularly do awful, invasive experiments on live, unmedicated Jewish identical twins.
That's crazy.
He stitched them together. He'd like hold one, he'd strap one down and then do awful things to the other one to see if the other one was getting the same reaction.
That is so stupid.
Like, he would like put Jewish people in ice cold baths and then turn the cold down and down and down and down to see what temperature it took minimally cooling to freeze them to death in water. You know, so they would do all these tests. It was just so profoundly horrendous and awful.
Yeah, so don't tell me not to make fun of them.
And Mengele died off the coast of Brazil or Costa Rica.
Oh, God, he had a good
at
life.
At like 88. He was swimming in the sea. That's how he
crazy
died.
That is.
What, right? Really quick. There's this doc on Netflix now with a lot of ex-top government officials working in the black ops side of the funding of the government. And a lot of them... The main guy, Dr. Stephen Greer, says that the US government believes that there are 6 alien civilizations in the Milky Way alone that we know of that aren't us.
Wow.
Based on the things that have shown up unacknowledged.
I need to watch that.
It's extraordinary.
It takes place in your head.
Yeah. It's the phenomenology of it. And it's like
that'd be a nice, because there is the Raelians, isn't there? The Raelians are in Florida, aren't they? I think. And they're run by a French dude called Nicholas Rael. They're basically a sex cult, but they believe that all life on Earth was seeded by extraterrestrials. So I'd imagine they probably do rituals that are to do with summoning aliens to Earth all the time and cuddling.
Well, it's just called learning. Pop out, find a book you want to know, and do some real learning. All real education is self-administered because you're learning from and contributing to your true source. If you're learning for curiosity's sake, not for the sake of duty, you're in tune with the infinite field of creative potential. That's learning, because that power of curiosity inside you is what some mystics and clerics may call God. Albert Einstein called his desire to get to the bottom of the universe God. I believe genius comes from just listening to yourself, being open to receiving messages inside. Find what's the God in you. Find a book. Give it the power you have inside you. Whatever way you choose to interpret what that power is or what its function is, find it and foster it. Listen to it. It could be anything, anything at all. And then give your power to a book and you will explode. Foster the power of curiosity inside yourself, and that in turn will foster the prosperity you'll find in your life, because you'll be negotiating with the very thing that makes you human. You'll be growing your consciousness and improving your emotional intelligence. The education system infers by its heavy, heavy focus on academia that emotional intelligence must be innate. That's bollocks too. All of us have the power to change ourselves for the worse and for the better. I'd go a step further and say the education system, when you're a teenager, insists on itself in your life so much that it stifles the cultivation of natural intelligence, because you have to work so fucking hard on these academic memory tests they've set for us. And when you're young, it's hard to see beyond the parameters of the education system and what the future holds if you don't follow its well-beaten track. Throughout my life, I've always read books on the side, whatever, as a contingency plan, perhaps, or as a means of wowing other people. Develop you, not them. Develop you and you'll be fine. Take an interest in you, a creation of such profound complexity and power that literally nothing else in the entire universe, to our knowledge, matches up. That's the truth. You have everything you need to live a full life. You have the greatest possible gifts a life form on this planet can receive. You are whole-minded. You are aware. Belief
and the refusal to accept such boring limitations as points in a leaving cert bring about conscious change, conscious growth. We do not need a system to grow. You have the power of the universe making waves beneath your boat, and you are steering the ship. The end.